Hi guys, my name is Matti Sulanto, and in this video I'm gonna take a look at the Sigma 14-24mm f2.8 full frame lens. This is a super wide angle zoom lens for L-mount and Sony E-mount cameras. The zoom range is from 14-24mm and the maximum aperture is fast f2.8. And the reason I'm not holding the lens in my hand like I usually do in these reviews, that I already returned the lens to Foca, which is the official importer, Sigma importer here in Finland. However, I have some B-roll for you so you can see the actual product and also some image sample as usual. And I also know that my t-shirt is kind of wrong today, but it's a Leica t-shirt and Leica has a lot of Panasonic DNA in their cameras, so I guess the t-shirt is okay for this once. And because I'm a Lumix ambassador, I was of course using this lens on my Lumix S1R. And all my findings are based on that. But of course, many of the things that I found out apply also to the Sony version, like image quality, for example. I believe it's pretty much identical whether you mount this lens on a Lumix camera or a Sony camera. Let's start with the build quality, which in my opinion is really, really excellent. I haven't seen a bad quality Sigma for a long, long time. I think since they started their very first art series lenses, their quality has been excellent. The build quality, that is. The exterior is mostly metal and some composite, and everything feels nice and tight, and the lens really, really feels like a pro-grade lens. And it's made in Japan, which seems to be very important to many. Even though I think bad products can come from any country, and also good products can come from any country. So if a lens or any product is made in whatever country, it doesn't automatically mean that the quality is good or bad, in my opinion. The zoom ring is really smooth all the way through the whole range, and so is the manual focus ring. But of course it's just an electronic manual focus, and it doesn't offer the same feedback as a real mechanical manual focus. There is a switch on the side of the lens for the autofocus manual focus, and there's also the AFL button. But I have to say, I forgot to check if the button is programmable using a Lumix camera, because I don't usually use those lens buttons on any lens. And now is a good time to check out some pictures that I've shot on this lens, and after the pictures I'll talk about the optical performance and all that. This lens is relatively compact for a super wide full frame lens with the maximum aperture of f2.8. However, it's not really like a pocket size lens by no means. The weight of this lens is just under 800 grams. And there is no filter thread because of the lens design. The front element is bulging out, and the integrated lens hood also prevents using any filters. However, you can still use filters. There's a filter holder on the back of the lens, or the rear of the lens. And the lens comes with this stencil that you can use to draw the outline of the filter on a gel filter, and then you can cut out the filter and put it in the filter holder on the back of the lens. Unfortunately, I didn't have any optical quality filters, so I couldn't try it. You can't, of course, use any kind of plastic filter on the back of the lens because that will degrade the image quality. But if you have optical quality gel filters, you can cut them to a proper size and shape and use them on this with this Sigma lens. The lens balances quite nicely on the S1R camera body. However, the zoom ring is opposite direction to Lumix native lenses, and I also learned its opposite direction to native Sony lenses. And this lens is only available for Lumix and Sony. So I can't really understand what Sigma designers were thinking when they designed the zoom ring to turn the opposite direction. I'm sure they have a reason for it, but at least I can't think of any very good reasons to do that. I think it would make sense to make the zoom ring turn the same direction as the native lenses or the first party lenses, because that would make it much easier to and faster to use the lens and adapt to the lens. The optical construction is 18 elements in 13 groups, which is slightly less complex than the 24-70mm f2.8 Sigma. The design includes one FLD element and five SLD elements and three aspherical elements, and one of the aspherical elements is the front, really big front element, and all those special glass elements and aspherical elements are there to make the image quality better and suppress unnecessary chromatic aberrations and all that. There's also Sigma's new NPC coating, which supposedly works great in backlight situations, and based on my experience with this lens, it really works. The lens is very, very resistant to backlight flare or reflections. And there's also 11-bladed round diaphragm, which helps to create smooth background, even though a super wide angle like this is never gonna be a real bokeh monster, obviously. And the minimum focusing distance is 28 centimeters, which is nothing spectacular. This lens it doesn't have any exceptional close-up capabilities, but it focuses close enough to emphasize that close-up foreground if you want to do that. The optical construction does not include image stabilizer, but at least on Lumix cameras, that's not a problem. You can easily shoot 1 second, 2 second handheld exposure on your Lumix S series cameras at least. I can't say anything about Sony stabilizers, but at least the Lumix in-body image stabilizer is very, very good. And then about the sharpness, that's the most important thing on any lens. And this Sigma really is an awesome lens in that regard. It's really, really sharp at all apertures, at all focal lengths. And like always, my findings are based on normal shooting and eyeballing the pictures in Lightroom. But based on that, the lens is really, really awesome. You get a slight bump in the sharpness when you stop down just a little bit to f4, f5, 6. But even wide open, the lens is really, really good. I was truly surprised how sharp this lens is. Vignetting is usually more or less of a problem on a super wide angle because the super wide design by nature creates some vignetting. And on the Sigma, the vignetting is partly corrected in camera or in Lightroom. So at least in the pictures that I was viewing in my Lightroom, I didn't see any distracting vignetting at any aperture. And the same goes for distortions. They are, in my understanding, partly corrected in camera or in Lightroom, and I can't see any distortions, which makes this lens very suitable for something like architecture where straight lines are important. I already said something about the diaphragm blades and the bokeh, and there's nothing much to say about the bokeh. I think it's just as good as it can be on a lens like this. This is not your bokeh monster, but you can create some blurry background if you shoot wide open and your subject is close enough. The autofocus works fine. I only shot photographs on this lens, not video, so I can't say anything about that. But at least for photography, the autofocus works really, really well. It's fast and reliable. Also, the manual focus works really well for electronic manual focus, but I don't think you're gonna need manual focus very often because the autofocus is so good. And my conclusion with this lens is that it's a really awesome super wide angle zoom lens for the L mount and Sony E mount cameras. It's well built, it's weather sealed, it's super sharp, and it has fast f2.8 constant maximum aperture. And I'm going to repeat what I said in my Sigma 24-70mm review. I feel really sorry for other than Lumix and Sony users because this lens is not available for those. But maybe and hopefully in the future, Sigma will decide to make this lens also available for Canon and Nikon mirrorless cameras. Thanks so much for watching. And by the way, there's the Sigma 24-70mm f2.8 review, and there's another Sigma review here. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.